See, this is where I had to pull a Dodge Ram off the alignment rack last night.
Not only can you not get it that the door closed with that big truck on here, but every night it shuts itself off for some reason. I don't know why.
How you doing? Thanks for tuning in. I'm glad you're here. I'm Jimmy. We're making it work. And you might realize I'm only wearing a t-shirt because it's 68 degrees out this morning. Beautiful. It's going to probably be in the upper 70s today. Kind of strange. It was 40-something degrees the other day. But we got beautiful skies. We got chemtrails, also known as vapor trails. Jet engine exhaust cooks the steam moisture in the air. Leaves trails in the sky and make people freak out. Anyway, enough about science. The science is going to happen in the shop today. We're going to learn a thing or two, me and you, and we're going to have some fun. I'll put some clips in right here. What's going to happen in this video? Got the sensor. It's a 2020 Hyundai Tucson. Body shop and alignment. It's a farm truck, basically. 2014 Kia Forte. You can probably see that chemtrail behind me. But nothing to worry about. Everything's under control, don't worry. Just breathe normally and let it take its course. I apologize. So you guys see what's gonna happen in this video today. I'm anxious to get in there and find out myself. I have no idea. I know I gotta finish that Ram 3500 right there, you see. We'll get that back in the rack. I got the heads all set up, ready to go. It barely fits to the back of the rack to do a compensation forward, but we're gonna give it a try. And then we got a Mazda and a Kia out in the parking lot as well. I don't know if you saw that in the clips, but we'll find out what's gonna happen. Parts for the Silverado are on the way. There's gonna be a lot to do today. Stay tuned. Now, messing with the angle of the dangle here, I'm wondering if these mirrors are gonna block the heads, so I'm just gonna fold them in, just in case. And then we're gonna drive this thing forward from inside the truck. See, anytime you block a head, it disappears, but the angle of that thing is just about right where the mirrors might mess with it. Anyway, let's jump inside, see if we can compensate it or not. Sometimes with all the spacers on here and the big wide axles to begin with, it doesn't like to see them. Like this box corner can block it and all, but not gonna stop us from trying. Look at a seat port thing. Oh, something else I noticed too. Made in Mexico. Ram trucks. That's not that that's a terrible thing, but it's not made in America. Doesn't mean it can't be a good truck. Now I can't even see the screen because of the hood. I'm just gonna roll forward and try to look in the mirror. Let's go see what the screen looks like before we shut it off. Target was blocked. Please roll again. That's a bummer. All right, I think we got something to happen. Don't move wheel, will you? Don't move wheel. Took four tries, moving the heads, adjusting the position on the rack. This might be a problem here. Well, it didn't move the sensor. That's why the truck was moving when I was sweeping the caster. It's pretty funny. She's tweaked pretty good. What's funny is the left front's where I mounted the tire and wheel. The TPMS system thinks it's the inside rear that's on the left front, can't see the sensor. And actually got to roll this back a little bit. That's going to be interesting. I wonder if the head moved. I might have to try it again just in case the head moved, because that's something's not right with that measurement. And we're awful close to the lift. All right, I'm wondering if it came past this and touched as a tire rolled. We'll try a fifth attempt at it. Took five attempts at compensation and caster sweeps. Now it's just showing me the wheels off, because I've got the wheel was to the left. I straighten the wheel out. I should just be able to set the toe or the drag link, and we should be good. Let's It's showing the rear's a slight bit out, but nothing crazy. It's got a solid differential, obviously, in a heavy truck. So, all right. Let's go ahead and adjust this toe, see what it looks like underneath. That's how you start the day right there. 18 millimeter on the lock nut. That nut's probably an inch and an eighth, inch and a quarter. I got both right here. You see, these really try to turn the steering wheel rather than the tires, but we'll see what happens. I guess the tires are easier to move. So I want to go to the left. So the threads, if I turn this counterclockwise towards the tie rod end, the threads are angled that way. It should pull it shorter and pull the wheels over. That's what I hope. May take a turn or two. Must have been whacked pretty hard. I sprayed it down with deep creep. That should help too. And I'm gonna have to, when I get the wheel centered, the toe's about the same left and right. Now I'll have to lengthen this one, which goes from wheel to wheel. And I can get my toe out from that, and this straightens the wheel. And so I may have to get someone up top to help. Sometimes it moves the wheel a lot easier than it moves the rest. But we'll try it. We'll see. And this one has a channel lock requirement, Knipex, we also call them. Now this one, to tow out, I want the threads to go out. So this one's gonna go clockwise. Got my Dodge Ram tie rod adjuster. Now it's saying it moved the wheel. So we'll go back and forth for a little while. We'll dance and see if we can make it happen. Oh, we're getting close now. Oh yeah. Just about perfect. A little bit more on this. Towed back in. A little bit more on this. Back out. That should be close. Gonna lock these down, go up and check the steering wheel. This goes back to old info when you go look at virtual view. It's kind of weird. This is live data right here. Anyway, I already printed out some copies. Look at that thing. Green. We had to dance for quite a while. We worked on it about an hour and a half yesterday and about 45 minutes today. So that's what it pays, 2.4. So we're all right. Don't worry about that. I gotta go up and check the wheel again one more time, just to make sure it's gonna be straight going down the road. Now I switch everything back to the short arms. Because most likely, I think we got three or four more cars to do for the body shop. All right, now got the sensor all tightened up in there. Connector, I took off the injector back on. Connector back in the sensor. We're good to go with this thing. I'm gonna do a little more cleanup. I wiped everything down already, but I'm gonna wipe it down one more time. And then we'll put that intake back in and see what our data looks like. If you remember from the first video on this truck, I had two high pressure data PIDs in the 500-600 PSI range. That fuel line on the frame is not at 500 plus PSI. It should be about 60 or so, I would think. So, we'll see. Only one way to find out is to carry on. Sound insulator. This big foam rubber dealio. That's all it does. Makes it so the driver doesn't go back to the dealership going, why the heck's the engine rattling? That should be good. Paper towels are out. Don't forget those. Got all new gasket, but my screws are back in on the stupid cover that doesn't really come off like they said. Now I'm gonna have to jiggle this in because the bolts are gonna not wanna cooperate. Sometimes I gotta lift them up, like on the older ones I'm talking about. You have to lift them up and jiggle it back, lift them up and jiggle it back, etc. like to lie to you. I'm not much for lying. I did not start these by hand because you really can't. It would be tedious. And the manifold holds them completely straight. So as long as it all drops down in the right spot, you're good to go. I will start them all with my little electric ratchet carefully. And we'll go from there. Got that one ready. These get tightened to 44 inch pounds and then 89 inch pounds. Can't really feel it. Definitely can't see it. It's amazing how giant these trucks are nowadays. And there's no room to work on the engine. I mean, this is honestly one of the easier ones, but still, you know what I'm saying? Could be even easier. So, let me get a light. Now, show yourself to me. This is Sparta. This is one of the exciting things about auto repair. You're like, hey, should be easy. Just tighten the bolts. Okay. It's about to get real up in here. Whew. Had to angle my head just right to see through the other hole. Don't worry, we'll get it. Sheer willpower and determination. That's all it takes. I already did the 44, now we're doing the 89. There are sequence to these. Once you look at the diagrams, it just goes 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 in a circle. So, not really very hard at all. Couple of connectors here. I'm gonna put my purge valve in. Once I get this air box back on, we'll grab the scanner. See what it says. Damn, playing with how tight these bellows are on here, you basically don't even have to have a clamp. Just for added security, I guess. Got my breather lines clicked on there. Let's grab the scanner. All right, we're gonna use the X tool on this one. You might remember the minus 40 degrees. I used two or three different scanners to make sure that it was accurate and I wasn't scan tool corruption or something, corrupted data. So we're gonna use this again. Trying to give this tool the benefit of the doubt here. Obviously it works, but there's a lot of little glitchy things and you gotta really jump through some hoops to do things that other scan tools seem to do a little easier. Not that it's not a capable tool. I just, they need to work the bugs out is what I'm saying. So we got no codes in the ECM, which I like. The EBCM code is weird. Let's clear those and see if they come back. That'll run through the modules that had codes and clear them out. I couldn't clear that EBCM code before because I think it was seeing the minus 40 in the sensor. So hopefully that's fixed. I think the BCM codes are going to come back because they were something to do with either HVAC or TPMS. I forget. But we'll jump into this ECM module and we'll take a look at some data, see what that looks like. Codes are all gone. Nice. This had the 8-speed, I believe. I just don't know which one. Shouldn't matter. Like I said earlier, the module should have the same data function. So that's taking a little long. Live data. I want to see fuel system data. And I'm just going to scroll down here to fuel pressure or fuel temperature. Whichever one I see first, I know I'll be close. Desired fuel pressure, 3.4. I haven't turned the key on more than one time just to get the scanner hooked up. So that's going to read low. All right, let's start this thing up. Fuel trim reset. Reset. Successful. The scanner moves quick. It goes through the pages pretty quick compared to other scanners. Fuel composition sensor. 9.8 alcohol. We did also tell them we might need to do an update in the PCM, so that's very possibly what we're going to have to do here. If you remember when I looked at this vehicle, I think it was Monday. Today is Wednesday. It had a code for fuel pressure too high, and I noticed minus 40 in the data, but I didn't have a code for that. So I'm kind of hunting and pecking and realizing they have multi-purpose sensors now with three wires that do more than one function on the sensor signal wire. So the way this, there's a fuel temperature and alcohol content sensor on the frame rail somewhere down in the fuel line underneath, and I haven't looked at that yet. But our complaints don't match this problem. This is just something I've noticed. I gotta drive it. I may have already fixed the fuel pressure high code, but I don't know because I haven't driven it. I don't want to see minus 40 in my data parameters. So I'm gonna look underneath, and it's easier to lift it on this lift than it is to lift it on my lift inside. So we'll look around and see. What these will do too is blow fuse 43, which is something that sets like four or five different codes, causes weird transmission operation, no cruise control, because there's a temperature sensor underneath on the frame that the wires actually chafe. Sometimes they're hanging down and wires get broken. And they tell you just to cut them off and butt connect them sealed. So there's a few potential problems we could have to get that minus 40. Let's take a look. That's basically what I'm saying. I got the correct rag joint for the project truck, by the way. This rag joint was much bigger than the one that was on there, and the splines are bigger, so I had to fabricate this bracket to fit the wider hole spacing. So, but we haven't put it on yet because I painted it, letting the paint dry a little more. Focus. All right. Oh, I think this is the sensor she got me. Hopefully we still have that here. I'm probably just going to throw it in there if we do. This is the other sensor that causes the code 43 problem. See, it's not connected. Sometimes what will happen is these break off and they'll be hanging down and cut on this corner. And they just tell you, yeah, just get rid of it. We don't need it. We change our minds. And this is basically just a plug that closes it off. It's not even connected in the first place. So I am going to put it back on the holder so it doesn't cause a problem. And what I can do too is I can pull this connector off of here, plug it into our new sensor, and see what happens with the data. That's what I'm gonna do. Might as well keep it. Look at that son of a gun. That's the sensor they got me the first time. She said, we can't send it back. You might as well put it on. Okay, that's what we're gonna do. Now, I could put a scope on this, in all honesty. Ow, that's the one from the Dodge Ram rear end. It's almost healed. Still sore though, but you could put a scope on this. This is an excellent example of when I should put a scope on it. And if I didn't already have the part here, I would definitely do that to get them to. We even have the connector. She got me the connector for it too. I guess the Chevy guys told her, you're gonna want that connector. So I'm gonna have to be very mindful of that. Sometimes you can peel this tape back and just give it a tug and it'll break if it's corroded or detached inside. This might spray a little fuel here. Watch your eyes. But anyway, this is a good opportunity to use a scope. If I didn't already have the part, I'd put a scope in there, because the way this works is, has 5 volts going to the sensor pulls it to ground to let it know how much alcohol is in it, and then the pulse width determines the temperature. So if the pulse width is long, it's colder, and if the pulse width is short, it's warmer. From minus 40 degrees to 304 or 314 degrees. So, long story short, I'm gonna throw it in there and see what happens. I apologize. I know some people won't like it and they'll be mad at me, but that's okay. In the real world, sometimes the serious diagnosis starts after the parts have been put in. And I don't like doing it. I prefer not to. And if I didn't already have a part we couldn't send back, I would throw the scope on it. That's the long and short of it. This is original, so. Let's get the scanner, let this down, and we'll see. Alrighty then. We still got minus 40 in our data, which makes me pretty sad. And they said, take it for a drive, see if it resets the pressure code or sets any codes, and we'll go further if we need to. It shouldn't say minus 40 in the fuel pressure data, fuel temperature data. It could even be software. There is a software update they asked about, so I can verify that when we get back. But I'm gonna try wiggling that wire connector and see if I can get the data to change. I might have to switch to a wireless scanner to do that. This might reach through the open door, but the key on, engine off, looking at data, I can wiggle the connector and see if I get something from that. I could put my scope on it, but they don't want me to spend any more time on it. Which, that's another part of this business, but we got a lot of work today. We'll see. I'm going to drive it, see if I get any codes or check engine lights. When we get back, we'll check for that real quick, and then we'll see where we're going to go from there. I'm a little bit sad. All right. After about a 20-minute drive, no trouble code. Still got minus 40, but we'll see what happens. If they want me to go any further or if they let me, then we'll do it. Otherwise, there's got to be something else to do. We got a whole parking lot full of cars out here. I get back, there's a 2020 Hyundai Tonon in my bay. Looks like a brand new car. The heck? Hit something in the road apparently and lost all the coolant out the bottom.
We'll have to lift it up and take a look, but let's go inside.
41,811 miles. My goodness, a brand new car.
Love rating of 5. It'd be higher if it was a 10-year-old car, but let's see what they hit in the road to lose all their coolant. I don't see where she hit anything at all from up, from down below, so there's definitely something leaking up top because it's cooling on top of the transition. All right, you know what I'll do? We'll pull this air snorkel off, put some water in it, and see if we can see what we see. It's probably that fitting on the on that hose. I wouldn't be surprised if that's the culprit.
Stay on, I guess.
A little bit of agua. We'll see what's going on. All right, I'm gonna put some water in there. You guys keep an eye out. Let me know if you spot something. Uh-oh. Been drinking again. I'm gonna have to get the pressure tester on there. Sometimes they'll drip right out for you. Sometimes they won't. I always try it without pressure first, and then pressurize it if I have to. It's 50-50. She's a little dusty, don't let that fool you. It's like brand new inside. Now we gotta find a Hyundai adapter, which means it's not gonna be labeled for it, but something in here will work. I hope. Oh, that's a conventional style. No, it's threaded. These notches mean nothing. Looks like it's threaded in there. It's so odd. I don't understand why they do this kind of stuff. It's just so odd. Like, what I'm suspecting is leaking is this lower hose connection. Look at that cool new style clamp they put on it. They did away with the plastic water outlet housing and went to a new cool plastic hose connection that leaks. That's what it looks like. Could be the heater hoses underneath it, though. All right, let's find an adapter. This is a Toyota adapter, but the threads look like they're too coarse. Yeah, it's gonna damage the tank. I don't have the adapter. Nice. You know what? I do have the adapter. They got these conventional looking tabs, even though the cap doesn't use them. They have them on there so you can still pressure test it, I guess. Because this looks like it will work. I just tried it because I was like, what are the notches for? That's the Mercedes GM Acura Honda. Look at that, man. That's where I thought it would be leaking. So, it's a cool new idea they had, though. It doesn't work. It's more complicated. And a 3-year-old car has a coolant leak. So, good work. Kudos to the engineers that made it so you gotta buy a special tool to fix something that doesn't work.
She thinks that the one that you had.
Let me go let them know and see how we can get it. It's gonna probably have to come from the Hyundai dealer, I'm guessing. You're not gonna make something to fix that. You gotta get a new one. You know what time it is. Body shop and alignment. We're also gonna put a wheel on there. It's got a bent or damaged wheel from the accident day. So they're using a tire machine to do TPMS sensors right now. We'll go ahead and knock the alignment out. We'll put the wheel on afterwards. I think this is, yeah, that's it. They bumped into the coib pretty good. Uh-oh, is that a wheel lock? Nope, it's just damaged.
I don't wanna hurt anyone's feelings, but this wheel's damaged too. I gotta make sure which one we're doing. The left side one has way more damage, but this is also damaged. And it looks to me like it's a cover on top of a steel or aluminum wheel. Kind of like what Joe's putting TPMS sensors in that. It's got chrome covers on an aluminum wheel. It's a separate cover. It's kind of weird that they don't chrome plate the wheels anymore. Maybe it costs more money than making a plastic chrome cover. But I thought chrome was chrome. I guess not. All right, let's get the heads on this thing, get started. I think it's a 2021 Highlander hybrid. These are really nice cars for a family truckster. This is nice. You start it up, you don't hear the engine run, it drives on the battery. When the battery gets low, it runs the engine. So, 2021. I believe it's only got 38,100 loving miles. It's gonna be a 7 on the love rating too. Even from the body shop, you could tell that it hasn't been detailed yet. So I get a really good idea of how it was kept. Otherwise, I wouldn't rate it. Let's get the heads on it and verify that it's this wheel we're changing. This one's really got a lot of damage. I bet you the wheel's $1,100 a piece. All right, heads are on there. Begin alignment, VIN. It's okay, it's all right. There it goes. It's funny, someone saw my short, they said me and Joe's toolboxes had to be 120 grand. I think they've been conditioned for the Snap-on man. More like 12,000, which is still too much to me. Anyway, 38,100. What color is this? Light blue? Light blue. Boom. Okay. Now it's going to tell me about all the cool options and all the other work I got to do other than setting the tow and letting her go. The body shop, if you haven't seen my other videos when I do body shop alignments, they do all the ADOS and steering calibration stuff when the car is all repaired. So we normally don't do that for the body shop. It's not that it's hard, but they want to pay the minimum. They get a big discount for bringing us all their alignments. So they pay like half price. So that's also part of the deal, is they take care of that when we're done. So let's go ahead and roll this thing forward. I'm going to do that from inside the car. We'll do the compensation, which tells the heads, tells the machine how the heads might be off a little bit after about a quarter of a turn. Gets a pretty good idea and adjusts for that. Compensates for it. And then we'll do a caster sweep holding the brake. We should be good to go from there. Maybe it'll be nice and green. It bumped that wheel pretty good. I wouldn't be surprised if it's towed in the left front a little bit. We'll see. These are super nice cars. A lot of people don't like them. There's not a lot of, you know, it's not like a sports car. There's no real romance. So now it just says ready. If you're not familiar with hybrids, right now we're ready to go. You just put it in drive. There's no running engine. Let off the brake and it'll move forward. Dunk, dunk, dunk. The plate's loosened up right there. I like the compensation. Now I can hold the brake pedal and do my caster sweep. The reason you don't want the wheels to roll is because it's looking at camber inclination. What that means is, as the wheel rolls through the arc, the camber on the axle changes. And so as the wheel goes left, it goes down. And as the wheel goes up, goes right, it goes up. So what that's doing is telling it how much caster there is. If the camber changes 2 degrees, it calculates how much caster that means it has. So really pretty cool to think about how all that stuff works. Sometimes it's hard to wrap your brain around it, but that's how I understand it myself. The axle going down to the left and up to the right. If it had negative caster, which is the upper ball joints forward of the lower, then the axle would go up to the rear and down to the right, which they used to do that in the old days with manual steering and stuff. But all right, looks like the right rear's got to go first, and then we can do a little more negative in the front. We'll be good. Lock the steering wheel. Don't want it moving while we're adjusting it. Wheel's already straight. We did that while it was on. That's why they're all going to electric steering and electric master cylinders, because hybrids don't have a gas engine turning the belt, and there's no vacuum, right? So everything's electric. The car and the steering and the brakes. I'm gonna try not to crush the screen, but you can see that it's towed in a little bit in the right rear. So we need that wheel to go out. So I gotta move this bolt in, because this is in the back, right? Behind the axle. This big giant bar that holds the coil spring also adjusts the toe. So I wanna bring this in. Right, back of the wheel in, brings the front out, right? This is a 19 on the lock nut. Uh-oh, that's the wrong one. I got that on my extended reach. Look at that electrical stuff. This is actually an electric motor. This car is all-wheel drive. and I don't believe the gas engine is attached in any way. It's only electric to the rear wheels. Some people hate this stuff, but I think technology is awesome. I love it. I'm probably gonna get my wife a hybrid version of her Corolla Cross when they come out, when they get a little cheaper, I should say. When they're selling them really well and they can't keep them on the lot, they're expensive, but I don't wanna pay full price. And I used two ratchets instead of wrenches because of this lip on the frame. Makes it a little less fun. All right, two ooga-doogas, onto the front. I'm not trying to brag, but I think I called that one pretty good. The way it hit the wheel towed in a little on the left front. I should start doing this professionally. Between shotgun auto services and good guesses, top of the line. this is really tight. Let's see. Even a gear wrench is capable. That's another thing I always like to hear people. Gear wrenches don't loosen stuff. Okay. I think that people, you know, if you spend $1,000 on a set of wrenches, they have to be the only thing capable of doing the job. But I'm just saying, admit that you just wanted a really expensive wrenches. Don't tell people they need them. That's just what you wanted, and that's fine. But to tell people their stuff is junk and it won't do the job is wrong. Don't fool yourself and try to fool other people because you spend a lot of money, tell them they have to. I mean, don't get me wrong, spending money on good tools is something that you earn over the course of your career. And if you want to do it, then do it. I just don't get why people go online calling each other names and stuff over it. Let people do what they want. You know what I'm saying? Print, that's what I'm saying. Look at this thing. It went from boo to yay. Just like that. Kunk, 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 kunk. The tire machine does not air up tires very quick. Paper out, oh no. And I used it last, so I can't even blame anybody else. We'll grab a hunk of paper and put it in there. We'll come back and get this thing printed. I always print two of these. Sometimes Katie will make a copy if you just print one, but I try to do two so she doesn't have to do that. She's slammed up there all the time, busy already. So we got this printed out. I do want to check my steering wheel, make sure it's still straight and all that's good. Like I said, we got a ton of these alignments. I may not film every one because it's going to be tedious for you guys. You don't want to watch four alignments in a row, right? So what the heck is going on out there? Some skunks having a fight or somewhere around here. let's move on to the next thing to do, and we'll see. Hopefully it's not in alignment for you guys' sake. That'd be boring. You got multiple size wheel nuts. I wanted to free the alignment rack up, so I'm just gonna do it here with a jack. Give that a second to work its magic. It'll start to squeal a little bit, it means it's about empty. Like to say, for those of you who don't know, when you take the tire off, you want that sensor on the other side, so you're lifting it over that first. And when you put the tire on, you want it on the opposite side, so you're putting it over the sensor last. We're going to reuse the sensor, so I definitely don't want to damage it. When I did that big truck tire, we were putting the new sensor in, it didn't matter. Valencia. We're on the aluminum too. We don't want weights on the outside. If we static balance it, static is 2 ounces. I'd rather not do that. I'd rather do aluminum too, where you put weights on the close to the outside in the wheel and on the outside inside the wheel. 2.75 further in at the top, and 0.75 we'll find out after we get the weights on the inside. Ah, you can see that's all those lights are lit up. That means I'm at the top. And the other side, you can see those weights coming around a second. There they are. Those go on the other side, or outside of the inner wheel. We'll see what it zeroes out to, or if it does at all. Usually if it's 0.25 or zero, I'm good to go. If it's 0.5 or more, I'll keep going. Oh, that's something happened. That's not right. Now it's going to tell me where I put the weights is wrong. Yep, right where all the weights are, it's telling me to put weights opposite. But I don't do that. I'll take those off. Let me spin it again just for kicks. That's not normal. Usually if the wheel's not spinning true, that would happen. But this wheel is locked in perfect. The tire has a little skip to it, but yeah. Okay, it's telling me to take weights back off now. So that's what we're going to do. Until this thing's zero, I will not give up. All right, it's insisting I put weights in two places, which that just means it found the second worst heavy spot. It's not something you do often, but yeah, I'm gonna live with that, 0.25. As long as it's not where opposite where I have these weights at, I can see it's not gonna kick till I'm about halfway up. So it wants another weight in there, but we're not gonna do that. That's anything under about a half ounce, 0.5, which is half an ounce, you're not gonna feel it. I prefer zeros, but you got to draw the line somewhere. You can't spend an hour and a half balancing a tire that pays 0.3. Plus, I know even though it might bother me, no one's ever going to feel that. Uh-oh, another awesome viewer sent me something in the mail. See what it is. Oh, a shirt, a note. My buddy Tim. Man, this guy's all right. Just wanted to send a quick note. Sorry to not make it for Christmas. The slow boat from China was too large for my paddle. Hope you like these. I used them nonstop and was looking for a Dunkin' Donuts gift card, but we don't have them in my area. Tim, the big boat. This guy is awesome, man. Thanks, Tim. My goodness gracious, bruh. We could be friends if you were closer. What the heck? We could be friends from far away, too. Let's see. Now you know the rest of the story. That's awesome. That is awesome. You guys, everyone that participates in this channel is awesome. And Tim is going above and beyond right here. This is Matco stuff. Oh my goodness gracious. Someone's credit card smoking. Very nice, man. I really appreciate that. I'm going to take these out of the package and we'll have a good look. See him up close. Matco too. We don't have a Matco guy anymore, but this is like bit driver sockets. And what I like about looking at the package without even opening it is I use these all the time. And I always have to add this extension to them. But guess what? Might not have to. Let's get them out of the box. I didn't want to bore you guys with opening the box, but check this out. Behold. Those things, that's like the perfect length that I always put my extension on them. That's, man, you're all right, Tim. You are all right. What I should have done is open them like this. All right, very cool, man. I gotta get back to work. That is super cool. Now we'll try them right there in the magnetic tray. 13, 14, 13, 12, 10, 8, 7. All the popular sizes. I could just grab one, boink, do a hose clamp, whatever. And they're 12.2. All right, focus, focus, back to work. Let's throw the X tool on this truck and see what this thing does on a Chevrolet pick'em up truck that's fairly modern. This thing, I don't think I showed you the inside yet. I might have skipped that in a couple of vehicles. I apologize. It's a little hectic today. Plus a lot of them are body shop cars. So this thing, 161,510 miles. It's a farm truck, basically. I'm gonna go ahead and turn this X tool on. It's got a pretty cool startup screen. All right, I know the hood's open. I know the door's open. I know you're upset. Don't be so sad. Let's give this thing a minute. It takes a minute or two to boot up. Once it's booted up, it's pretty quick though. But it's got a pretty cool boot up screen. They spent a lot of time on that. Now it goes to the Tron page. Good morning. Unsuccessful. I tried to send some pictures I took. I haven't figured out how to send a report on it yet. May not have the capability, but it'll do Bluetooth. You can send photos and video files, but you have to pair it to a Bluetooth device to do it. So if I pair my phone, it will probably do it. I just haven't done it yet. Anywho, keys on. Let's try auto scan, see what it'll do. 2016 Silverado. Engine must be off. That's not really true, but okay. I'm gonna run through codes. It definitely has a little bit of a rough idle, like a vacuum leak or something along those lines. When I first started up, I didn't feel it. And as it ran a minute and the idle came down, it started to feel a little rough. This might take a second. Give it about 10 more seconds and we're gonna come back if it doesn't do something by then. Huge. I was just reaching up to push the button to say nope. And this screen, it works about 10% of the time. This screen will come up and it'll go through all the modules really fast. And then the other 9 out of 10 times, it just sits there like this for, I've left it for 10 minutes. And it just sits there like this. It doesn't time out, tell you process failed or anything. It just stays like that. Kind of strange. And I keep saying I'm going to contact them. I just haven't had the time to contact them and see if this is a normal thing. Maybe these tools have some problems they have to work out still. Maybe I just got one with some problems. Maybe when you contact them to complain about it, they give you an update that you don't know about. I don't know. I am going to get to it and figure that out. They want me to do a video on it by the 5th of February. It's not looking good for them so far. Because if it stays the way it's been, where it doesn't really do stuff it's supposed to 9 out of 10 times, I have no use for it. And that's putting it the nicest terms I can. So you can see it's not doing anything. But yet if I tell it to go back, it'll say, do you want to stop auto scan? Do you wish to exit? Yep. System selection, engine control module. Now what I've experienced is once I go into this page, I can go back and it'll auto scan. Some kind of a glitch in the matrix, probably. Read trouble codes. Too lean, bank 1. Too lean, bank 2. Misfire detected. Fuel trim, cylinder balance, bank 2. Current. I'm going to pop the hood. That's why I already popped the hood. I'm going to open it up, and I'm going to look around for vacuum leaks really quick before I get too carried away with anything. We don't even need to go any further until I can see if there's a vacuum leak. Maybe someone left a duct off a hose under the hood. Something like that. Well, I see a lot of dirt and dust and debris, but I don't see any hoses left off or broken or anything like that. So now we're going to be looking more towards mass airflow sensor problems, something that affects both banks. O2 sensor usually wouldn't. Is that hose clamp loose? Oh yeah, that's hose clamp's loose. I just spotted something. I doubt that would cause a problem, but it could contribute. I know one thing, they've done some body work. Heck yeah. A little Rust-Oleum, some Bondo, fixed. Honestly, it's a farm truck, right? So what does it matter? It's actually pretty cool that they cared about taking a dent out of it. Let me snug that clamp up. Or should I look at data first? What do you think? I'm gonna snug it up and see if we see any trouble. It definitely has a rough idle. So tightening that clamp probably have little to do with that. It's so lean that it's rough. Could have low fuel pressure. Sometimes you can unplug the mass airflow sensor, put it in backup fuel, and see if it runs better. You know, it probably has a mass air problem. Or you can shotgun auto, throw one in there and see what happens, and then take it back out if it doesn't fix it to test on the next car. When I worked at the dealership, that's what all the drivability guys would do. They had a whole bunch of parts, and you're only working on 6 models of vehicles, basically, most of the time. They would just put parts in and see if it fixed it. If it didn't, then they'd go into wiring and stuff like that, but software a lot of the time, too. Anyway, let's tighten that clamp. Get the scan data, see what it looks like. Like I said, it's a farm truck, so don't expect too much. Got a whoopee cushion just deflated on me. That was weird. Got a lot of brass couplers and stuff. That's cool. Oh, you know what? They are different key rings for different areas on the farm, probably. None of my business. Stop playing with that stuff and take a look. Both banks misfire. Fuel trim cylinder balance, bank 2 specifically. That's probably where we're going to need to go first, bank 2. You could even have like a valve problem. If a valve's not closing and stuff, it messes with fuel trim on both banks, that kind of thing. So let's bring up misfire data. I'd like to see if we have a specific cylinder causing most of our problems. Very possible. Mechanical data. Ignition data, misfire data. Fire it up. I did check the oil, that's all full. It does have some valve train noise. And it does have cylinder 4 misfires on startup. Whoop. 6-4 engine speed. And one of the things now, I got 6 and 4 look like the two most offending cylinders. And what you can do too, sometimes you have a phaser problem on vehicles that have overhead cams. It'll have a phaser at one bank versus the other bank. These engines are have one cam in the center of the block and advances and retards the whole, you know, the whole engine. But cars that have, or trucks that have a cam over each cylinder head, it can adjust. One cam could have a phaser that's not working or a solenoid not working, and that cam will be out of time, and you'll see that whole bank will have misfires. And usually it'll set a cam position code, but not always. So we got misfires on 6 and 4, it looks like to me. And that can definitely cause lean codes. And it's bank 2 is the offending bank, according to that one code, the P219B, I believe it was. And these two cylinders could very well be causing it. So let's get a look at the spark plugs. On every GM V8 since 1955 is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Bank 1 is on the driver's side, bank 2 is on the passenger side, even cylinders, odd cylinders, however you want to slice it. Firing orders, 1-8-5-3-6-4-7-2. One of the reasons that Chevrolet engines go in almost every kind of car when someone's building a hot rod, it's because it's simple, they're all the same. So, which mechanics like that, at least I do. Let's take a look at some spark plugs. 2, 4, 6, and 8 on the passenger side of this thing. We're going to pull out the plugs out of 4 and 6, which are right there. You can get them to the wheel well a little easier. I use this tool, grab the metal insulator. If I look at the plugs and they're a little gassy, then I'll know I got a spark issue. And if they're not, then we'll look into fuel possibilities and things like that. Someone has changed the plugs and they smell a little. Let me pull the other one out. Look at that one. 6 was misfiring a little more than 4. Actually looks better than the other one. Usually there'll be a little bit more black on the plugs that are misfiring if it's because of ignition. So now I know we got to look towards something to do with fuel injector. We can do a fuel injector drop test where you energize the pump, see how much the fuel pressure drops for each injector times 8, and then you compare them to known good ones that aren't setting misfire codes. What's weird is it runs good at first, and as the idle comes down and it gets a little warmer, then it starts to run worse. Now we're going to go a little further. Cool thing that the X-Tool 819 model does is misfire graphic. So it's kind of like a graphed, like IDS style pattern, but not exactly the same. But it's showing you on a graph instead of in a data pid what the misfires look like. When I bring it off idle, only one cylinder really seems to misfire. And you can also see over here, cylinder 4 seems to be the only one misfiring it at about 1,700-1,750 RPM. Cylinder 4. And I can also hear noise. I don't know if you can hear that on camera, but I hear valve train noise. I'm wondering now if this thing's got something going on with the valve train. Let's watch the O2 sensors, see what they do at idle versus off idle. You can see 4, 6, and 8 are showing misfires. It's interesting, with 4 being the biggest offender, still continuing off idle to misfire. All right, let's see if we can bring that O2 sensor data up. It's just gonna basically show you what it's doing, even as far as, well, that's just gonna show me if the fuel trim's enabled or not. Gonna back out of that. Live data, fuel trim. I'm gonna find O2 sensor, left bank and right bank sensor 1. I don't wanna look at fuel trim, I wanna look at the actual O2 sensors. And it's gonna do what I'm expecting it to do is show lean, especially on bank 2. So we'll see. Bank 1, sensor 1, we're gonna do that one. And bank 2, sensor 1, we're gonna do that one. Combine. Now you can see up here, the data is bank 2, bank 1, sensor 1 is going under and over 0.45. It might be kind of hard to see, the screen's a little small. Bank 2, sensor 1 is staying lean all the time. Barely gets to 400 millivolts. So let's bring it up to speed. Okay, it is switching off idle. Both banks are switching off idle. It's only at idle that it's lean. This thing could have an intake manifold gasket leaking, and I've been chasing other things, trying to eliminate other possibilities first. Let's try testing that. Alrighty now. You can see my, I brought up the O2 sensors and the fuel trim. And you can see the fuel trim is going kind of crazy because I sprayed brake clean. And you can actually hear it if you listen really closely. I don't know if you can hear that, but the fuel trim's getting a little crazy. The short term gets mad, and actually it gets happy, I should say. But I can actually hear it hissing where it's pulling in brake fluid from somewhere in the intake gasket or a crack in the intake, something like that. So that pretty much locks that down. And if someone's already done a tune-up, we don't have to worry about that. It does have that one cracked coil tower, so I'll probably recommend that as well. We'll have to pull the intake off and see if it's got a crack or if it's just a gasket, which normally it's a crack and not the gaskets on these. So we'll have to see how far they want to dig into this. That brown line there is the short-term fuel trim for bank 2, right? So you see right now it's recovering. It's going back to about 3 or 4%, and it's going to add and add and add, and then the long-term will compensate. So the short-term trim stays closer, but watch when I spray it. I just want to clarify in case, it might be hard to see, but I'm going to spray cylinders 4 and 6 on the intake, and you watch the brown line, you'll see it dropping off because it's trying to remove fuel when I spray the brake clean there. It shouldn't make any difference. Should be zero change when I spray that if it's not leaking, right? But I'm going to put you guys closer and spray with brake clean. Now I stop spraying, I'll go back up.
I know it's kind of hard to see from here, but it's because that scan tool is not wireless, which is another reason I tell people, if you can afford the wireless, get a wireless scan tool. Anyway, we know what's wrong with this one now. Moving on, we'll see if there's something else to do while they work on this estimate. We got a Hyundai Tucson upper radiator hose. Heck yeah. Ow. Watch your elbow. It'll bang into stuff if you're holding the camera while you're walking a tight area. I'll be all right. Don't worry about me. Uh-oh. Where the heck? Thought it was going to be easy. Maybe not. Oh, okay. It's right there. What, big crybaby. It's a big deal. I am going to pull this back out again. It's got a cool little setup on here. You squeeze this and it releases. And that little white tab that's in there stops you from being able to squeeze it. No big deal, right? All right. Let's get to work. I got to get a light too. Might as well try them out now that we have them. It's kind of nice not having to get an extension and worry about the socket coming off of it and stuff. I like it. There we go. Now you. Get out of here. All right, there's a little clipper doodle. This is just a security measure. I'm going to keep that for the next hose. I can squeeze that, pull it off. That's a 10 millimeter under there. Holy moly, it's under this brace. But you know what? It's not going to deter me. I'm going to get a box wrench or an open end wrench. I'm going to get it off of there without getting too cray cray. Now, don't make me take the whole radiator support apart for this. I got a sawzall. Oh. Are you kidding me? Just barely. Holy moly. If it was a thread longer, it wouldn't fit out. Turkey. I've said it before and I'll say it again. It might make stuff a little harder to work on, but at least it's unreliable. You know, that's the thing that I find just amazing. If they came up with this weird stuff because it was way better, I'd be like, oh, well, you know, it's a little harder to work on, but it doesn't fail as often. But it seems like it's worse. They make it harder to work on and less reliable. I don't understand what their end goal is. Maybe to force you to buy new cars. People generally aren't going to buy a new car because you raise the price of a new car now. A decent new car is 40 grand. And I don't say that as a mechanic that would rather fix your car and see you get a new one. I have told people, right, there's a point where you give up on this thing and get a new car. But for the most part, you're going to fix it. Because new cars are ridiculously expensive. Maybe that's why they come up with this stuff, to make it worse and worse and worse to fix your old car. I got to get another tool that will fit. That big hose clamp tool will fit. We'll try one of the smaller ones. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. This I just squeezed and popped it off of there. No big deal.
Ow!
What the hell? Come on, man. These jagged pieces of metal sticking right out of there. You guys are killing me, man. 40-something years, 42 years doing this, I'm still surprised every time. I'm like, ow, why is it sharp there? That's a plastic radiator shroud. Yeah, it's sharp. Ow, that's a piece of metal for a bracket. Yeah, it's sharp. Ow, that's a radiator hose. Yeah, it's sharp. I'm going to show you, too, while I got this off. You can see this. See how it moves away from the rubber? It's cracked just inside the rubber. Car's 3 years old. We got a nice new one. No worries. It'll hold them over to 2027. No worries. How long do you expect it to last? Before I carry on, I'll get this clamp thing. So I don't have to worry about coming back to it. You guys know I don't like to leave stuff half done and come back to it. If I can avoid it, sometimes you can't. Make sure that clamp's trapped in the neck of the radiator. Now, this bracket, it's so close, I gotta put this in the plastic to fit it in there. So if I had to snap this side on. Put my little lock pin in. Just gonna tighten this one up. All right. That's in, that's clipped in, that clamps on. Time for one of these.
face paint. Again, I try not to tighten those crazy. If it's plastic or rubber, no matter what, as soon as you see that clamp kind of squeezing that material, it's done. You can actually split it. Whether this is like a plastic, a rubberized plastic kind of material, it'll still crack. So anyway, let's put a little coolant in this thing. And it's basically done. That was quick. I thought it would take a little longer. All right, let's fire this thing up. Let it run a little bit. We already knew that's where it was leaking. So we'll let it run, get a little heat and pressure in it. It'll pressurize itself and tell us if something else is leaking. I gotta rinse off a little bit of the coolant that's spilt with the garden hose too. That's gonna be too exciting. I'll just take care of that before I fire it up and we'll get to it. All right, coolant's full. Everything's rinsed off. We got basically a brand new car right here. Well, even before I fixed it, technically it was a brand new car. I'm really worried about the future. Where are we gonna be at a few years from now? When cars are all breaking, when they're 2 and 3 years old and just out of warranty. These parts are gonna be pretty expensive too. Let's see if there's something else to do. Let this warm up a little bit. I'm gonna have to keep an eye on it, make sure there is an air pocket. You guys might know the deal. Gotta get hot air off the fan when it turns on, and the fan should cycle off, and you should get hot air out of the heater. If those two things happen, you got no air pockets, you could take it for a drive and not have to be towed back, or not have to sit on the side of the road for 20 minutes letting it cool off a little bit. What you're looking at here is a 2014 Kia Forte Economy Sedan. AC is not working correctly, and apparently we did AC repair about a year ago, and he's hoping it's all free, and it might be. The only way we're gonna know is to check and see what's wrong with it, because air conditioning can stop working because it's overheating or all kinds of things. Although looking down at the compressor, it's hard to tell if that's wet or just shiny paint. So we're gonna figure it out. Let's go take a look inside this thing. Now it might look a little worse for wear. It's only got 110,000 miles on it, which that's not a lot of miles. Let me give her a 5 and a lev rating. I'm just gonna run it, see if the air works. The fan's off. There's definitely nothing happening. Go outside and see if it looks like the compressor's trying to turn. Supposedly we did a whole kit. Keep it down, caveman. Oh, the compressor is running. Yeah, it's definitely still warm in here. Let's see if the pipes feel like one's getting cold or not. We'll put the gauges on it. Let's see what the pressures look like. This one should be hot, the smaller one. I do feel some heat in it, but this one doesn't feel cold like it's supposed to. That's interesting. Expansion valve problem, something like that. Let's roll the machine over here. We'll hook it up and we'll answer the phone. The phone's ringing. See what's going on with this monstrosity. Let me get that phone. Well, that's not good. What's the low on Freon? Not making any high side pressure. That's strange. Let's put some Freon in there. We'll put 8 ounces in there. On the low side, so the low will go up first, and you'll see the high side rise if everything's working correctly. And there's no restrictions or anything weird like that. The way these work, if there's a restriction, one side will go higher, it'll start to spike, and the other side will go low, sometimes even go into a vacuum. And then all of a sudden the high side will start coming back down, because if it goes into a vacuum enough, it's not pumping Freon anymore. So then the other side will start coming down. Kind of a strange thing to watch, but it's also pretty rare that they're restricted that badly, but an expansion valve stuck closed, or a line hose that collapsed, just like in a brake hose collapsing. An air conditioning hose can do the same thing. It's multi-layers of rubber. So it's something to keep in mind. We'll get the temp gun if we need to, or the infrared camera, and see if we can find a restriction, if that's the case. But I suspect it's just low on Freon. And if the low side doesn't go under about 18, 20 PSI, it just keeps the compressor on and doesn't do much. If there's enough Freon in there to turn it on and all, it'll get lubrication. It's not too mad about that. But if it goes below the level it wants to see for lubrication, then it'll turn the compressor off. using this bi-directional switch right here normally. There it goes, so it's got a leak somewhere. We're gonna have to find a leak. Could even be leaking from the compressor. If it is, then it'll be under warranty. Yay! I think we get a 3-year, 36,000-mile warranty. It's a really good warranty through Napa Service, Napa Care. I'm gonna lift this thing up and look for a leak if it gets cold inside. Oh yeah, that's a lot better. It's about 80, maybe even 90% of where it should be. If I was gonna guess temperature, 50 degrees or so. For Florida, that's pretty good. I don't know about where you're at. If you're in a cooler, drier climate, you'll get another 10 degrees, 8 degrees cooler probably, but let's look for a leak. I'll lift this thing up. I'm not gonna turn the light on my camera just to give you guys the full effect, the full Monty. You don't even need the lenses to see that. The hose is spraying up onto the compressor, by the way. It's not that the compressor is spraying down to the hose, I don't think, but I'm gonna make sure. We're gonna run it. I don't have it running right now. I wanna see it even brighter. Look at that, it's crazy, isn't it? Let's start it up running, and maybe we'll get the camera, and we'll try to watch it bubbling out of somewhere. See if it's going down from the compressor onto the hose, or from the hose spraying up onto the compressor. It's definitely making a mess down here, that's for sure. Let's see. That's the hose. Yeah, I might have to do soapy water. There's too much dye. I could clean it off, but we'll try soapy water first. Interesting. Inconclusive. All right. You want to get mean? We'll get some brake clean. We'll spray it down. See where the dye comes out first. I wonder if intermittently the fan doesn't work and that little valve is pushing Freon out. I think that's a bolt though. No, that might be a valve. No. There's a valve here, I think. I don't know. Let's just get it to show itself. We'll clean it up and let it run a minute. That's not right. All right, filled it up. Wanna play mean? I'll play mean back, that's all. We'll just go full Rayman Ray on this thing. I don't know why whenever I waste brake clean, he pops into my head first. There's a lot of people that waste it. Oh, that's not sufficient. I gotta clean it some more. That's how you want to be. We can do it. All right. This thing's been running a while. And that's the only dye I can see right now. How it got up there on the compressor earlier, it had to be getting blown up going down the road or something, but the hose is obviously porous, so it needs that high side hose. And I'm assuming that air was pushing it upwards from the hose onto the compressor as it fills with oil and dye, spraying it up onto it. So we'll let them know it needs that hose, and we'll see what happens with this car. We'll start putting this stuff all the way. We're not done yet, but we're getting close. The guy with the Silverado, he ran out of here with his hair on fire. I think he's gonna put a manifold on himself. He wanted to know what was wrong, so we'll see what he could order on Amazon. I said, check out my Amazon store. I didn't really say that. Probably should have. All right, guys. We are doing the opposite of opening the shop now. We're shutting the shop down. That's not how we usually say it, but that's how we say it on a family-friendly channel. Oh, I did a quick alignment on this body shop car too. I didn't video it because I didn't think you wanted to watch. I did like 4 or 5 alignments today. Would have been pretty tedious to keep filming those, but I appreciate you watching the ones I did film and spending some time with me today. It helps get me through every day. Especially Tim sending that stuff out. I mean, all you guys, even just clicking the like button, subscribing, leaving me a comment, letting me know you enjoyed the video or how dumb I am about something, whatever you want to do. Any participation in the community is a win for me and makes me really happy. So I hope you'll tune in for the next one because you're awesome.